Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the fourth video in our STM32 Ethernet series using the W5500 module. In this video, we'll learn how to use the STM32 as a TCP client. In the previous videos of this series, we covered the basic connections, module initialization, performing a ping test, and creating a TCP server on the STM32. Now, it's time to move ahead and use the STM32 as a TCP client, which will communicate with a TCP server. For demonstration purposes, I'll first create a local server on my computer. Along with that, we'll also connect the STM32 to a public TCP server on the internet. The STM32 will connect to this public TCP server by resolving its DNS. This means we'll be able to use the host name instead of manually entering the IP address, making it more flexible and realistic for real-world applications. We'll continue using the same project from the first part of this series, which already includes the basic initialization for the W5500 module. Let's start by renaming this project to Part 4 and make sure to check the Update References option while doing so, to avoid any broken links within the files. Once the project has been renamed successfully, we'll copy the TCP client header and source files into this project. You can download these files from the link provided in the description of this video. Inside the downloaded folder, you'll find all the necessary library files placed inside the Ethernet directory, the same location where I'm placing them right now. Let's take a look at the tcpclient.c file now. At the beginning of this file, you'll find an option to enable DNS resolution. This feature allows the STM32 to connect to a TCP server using its hostname instead of a fixed IP address. To enable it, simply uncomment the DNS definition at the top. Once that's done, the STM32 will be able to resolve the hostname automatically using Google's public DNS server. We'll see this in action shortly. Next, we need to define the W5500 socket that the TCP client will use. As I mentioned in the previous video, the W5500 chip provides 8 available sockets in total. Here, we use socket 0 for our TCP client. After that, define the TCP server port. This is the port number where the client will connect. If your TCP server uses a hostname, define that hostname here. You also need to define the socket number used by the DNS service and its DNS server IP. In this example, I'm using socket 6 for DNS and the IP address of Google's DNS server. However, if you're connecting to a server with a static IP, simply define that IP address here instead. For this demonstration, I'll create a local TCP server on my computer, so the IP address defined here will be that of my local machine. Alright, let's now explore the available functions in this TCP client source file. The first one is TCP client init. This function initializes the TCP client and establishes a connection with the TCP server. At the start of this function, the socket function is called to assign and open a socket for the client. Here, port 3000 is used as the client's communication port. Once the socket is opened, we use the connect function to connect the client to the TCP server. The server's IP address is passed as a parameter to this function. If the connection uses a hostname, the server IP will be obtained after DNS resolution. If a static IP is used, it will already be stored in the buffer. After calling connect, we continuously monitor the status register. If the status value becomes 0x17, it indicates that the connection has been successfully established, and data transfer can begin. If a timeout occurs instead, the client will close the socket and exit the configuration process to prevent it from hanging. The next function is TCP client handle, which is responsible for sending and receiving data from the TCP server. This function takes a parameter that represents the data to be transmitted. Inside this function, we again check the status register to confirm that the connection is active. If it is, we proceed with communication. Before transmitting data, we check whether there's actually any data to send. This conditional check is helpful. If the client doesn't have data to transmit, it can still remain connected just to receive data from the server. To send data, we use the send function, and to receive data, we use the receive function. Both of these are blocking functions, meaning they hold the CPU until the operation completes. While sending data doesn't cause much delay, the receive function will block further operations until the server sends a response. Once data is received, we log it on the serial terminal for observation. If the server closes the connection, the status register changes to 0x1c. When this happens, we call the disconnect function to properly close the socket. After both sides close the connection, the TCP client init function is called again to automatically reconnect the client to the server. If you don't want the connection to restart automatically, you can simply comment out this part of the code. That's everything we have in the TCP client source file. Now, for testing, I'll use the Packet Sender application to create a local TCP server. All I need to do is click on the TCP button to start the server. Once it's running, you'll see the port number displayed in the application. We'll take that same port number and enter it in the tcpclient.c file. Alright, with that done, let's move on and see how to use this TCP client library in our project. Inside the main file, start by including the tcpclient.h header file. Then, inside the main function, once the W5500 module has been initialized, call the TCP client init function. This will initialize the TCP client and attempt to connect it to the configured TCP server. If the initialization is successful, the function will return zero. Next, inside the infinite loop, call the TCP client handle function to manage communication between the client and the server. In this example, we'll make the client send a piece of data to the server every 1 second. Let's go ahead and build the project now. You might notice a few compiler warnings, but they can safely be ignored for now. Once the build is complete, flash the project to the STM32 board. Now open the serial monitor to observe the logs in real time. The TCP server has already been created using Packet Sender, so we should start seeing the data sent by the STM32 client appear right there. As you can see on the serial console, the module has been initialized, the device has obtained an IP address, the client successfully connected to the server, and data transmission has started. Let's switch to the Packet Sender window. Here, you can clearly see the server receiving data every second, the same data being sent repeatedly by the STM32 client. Right now, the server is configured to close the connection immediately after it receives data from the client. That's why we see a receive error in the logs. Once the connection closes, the client automatically tries to reconnect again. However, Packet Sender also provides an option to create a persistent TCP server. When this mode is enabled, the server will keep the connection open, and the client can continue communicating without frequent reconnects. Now, after enabling the persistent server, you'll notice that the client sends data once and then waits for a response. Let's try sending something back from the server to the STM32 client. As soon as we do that, the received data appears on the serial console, confirming that the client successfully received it. The client then sends another packet and waits again. This loop continues indefinitely since the code handles communication inside a while loop. Now, let's consider another scenario where we want the client to only receive data from the server without sending anything. To achieve this, we simply pass zero or null as the parameter to the TCP client handle function. Let's build and flash the project again with this modification. I'll first disable the persistent TCP server. According to the logs, the connection gets established successfully, but the client doesn't transmit any data this time, just as expected. Now, let's enable the persistent TCP server once more. When the STM32 client reconnects, you'll see that it no longer sends data but instead waits to receive something from the server. After a short while, when the server closes the connection, the client again attempts to reconnect automatically. This confirms that the STM32 TCP client is now working in receive-only mode, where it receives data from the server but does not send any response. So far, we've seen the STM32 functioning as a TCP client connected to a server with a static IP. It can successfully transmit and receive data, and we've also demonstrated how to configure it to only receive data when needed. You can further modify the TCP client handle function to match your specific requirements, such as adjusting timing, message format, or response handling. In the next step, we'll explore how to connect the STM32 to a TCP server that uses a hostname instead of a static IP address. This will allow us to test DNS resolution and make the client more adaptable to real-world applications. We need to use DNS to resolve the IP address of a server that uses a hostname, so let's start by enabling the DNS definition in the code. For this demonstration, I'll use a public TCP echo server, tcpbin.com. The TCP server port for this echo server is 4242, so let's go ahead and define that as well. That's all the configuration we need to do inside the tcpclient.c file for this setup. Now, I want the client to send different data each time it communicates with the server. To achieve this, we'll define a counter variable that increments every time the data is sent. Inside the while loop, we'll first prepare the data that will be transmitted. We use the sprintf function to store this data, along with the updated value of the counter variable, into a buffer. Once the data is ready, we'll pass this buffer as the parameter to the TCP client handle function. Let's also make sure to define the buffer array properly. Remember to include the carriage return and line feed characters at the end of each message. This is a requirement from the TCP bin echo server for proper response handling. Since we are using the sprintf function, don't forget to include the standard IO header file at the top of the source code. Now, let's build and flash the project to the STM32 board. Once the flashing is complete, open the serial console to view the logs in real time. If everything is configured correctly, you should start seeing echo responses coming back from the TCP server. As shown on the console, the server is indeed echoing the same data that the client sends, which means the communication is working perfectly. Let's look at the process step by step. Before connecting, the client resolves the DNS of the hostname tcpbin.com. After successfully obtaining the IP address, the client establishes a connection to the server. Then, each time the client sends data, the server echoes it back, confirming two-way communication. You also notice that the client's data updates each time, reflecting the incremented value of the counter variable, and the same updated message is echoed by the server. So, the STM32 as a TCP client is now working flawlessly. We have successfully made it connect to TCP servers using both static IP addresses and hostnames. In both cases, the client was able to send and receive data without any issues. For more advanced applications, you can even integrate FreeRTOS so the STM32 can perform other tasks concurrently while waiting for data from the server. To do this, just follow the same approach demonstrated in the TCP server with FreeRTOS video, the link for that is provided in the description below. That's it for today's video. You can download the complete project from the article link in the video description. If you have any questions or run into issues, feel free to leave a comment below. Thanks for watching, and as always, have a great day ahead.